As you had seen that during 1990, a number of things changed in world politics, and the scale and scope of the changes in India's foreign policy since the end of the Cold War has been quite impressive. Yet there has been little conscious articulation of the logic and purpose of India's changing new foreign policy orientation, either by the political class in power or the permanent bureaucracy, because as you know that bureaucracy is the actual articulator of domestic or foreign policy, because they are the ones who have to implement it. This was due in part to Delhi's strategy of incremental adjustment rather than revolutionary transformation. India believed in gradual change in its foreign policy, and so there was no revolutionary transformation in our foreign policy. Unlike Deng Xiaoping in China, who defined a set of national and international objectives and strategies for China in the post-Mao era, the Indian leadership at the turn of the 1990s could not and did not disown the inherited political legacy. It moved with great caution and much aversion to any significant risk. India's improved economic performance and international expectations of commercial opportunities in a globalized or we can say in a globalizing India provided New Delhi the much needed incentive, time and space to reconstruct, to reinvent its foreign policy after the culmination of Cold War. Despite much uncertainty in domestic politics at that time, India's foreign policy evolved in a relatively stable manner under several prime ministers heading different coalitions since 1989. There was Narasimha Rao, and after him H.D. Devegowda, I.K. Gujral, and then for some time there was Atal Bihari Vajpayee, and again there was Atal Bihari Vajpayee with the majority, but he formed government with the help of some other parties. Then there was Dr. Manmohan Singh. So a large part of this period was spent in formation of coalition governments, governments which did not have a clear majority. Many of the innovations in India's foreign policy in this period were initiated in 1980s by prime ministers like Indira Gandhi and Rajiv Gandhi, who sought to ease the many rigidities that had accumulated in India's foreign policy. New outreach to United States and China, the attempt to normalize relations with Pakistan and engagement with Israel, all these eased to some extent India's rigid stance towards the world. And it all happened before 1990, and this paved the way for change in India's foreign policy after 1990. The end of the Cold War had altered the external environment demanding that India should also examine its core assumptions of foreign policy. But unlike Rajiv Gandhi and Indira Gandhi, the prime ministers who followed them did not command massive support in the parliament. All of them had to work within coalition governments. And this proved to be a constraint on our foreign policy formulation. India's adverse balance of payment and it escalating into a crisis at the turn of 1990s coincided with the fall of Berlin Wall, and it demanded significant policy change on both economic and foreign policy fronts. The 1990s also saw profound disturbance in India's frontier states like Punjab, Jammu and Kashmir, and the Northeast. The heartland was also in tumult as caste and religion played havoc with India's domestic policy, and they were the major sources of conflict at that time. Here, in this lecture, we will focus on three themes in India's foreign policy and its evolution since 1990. First is re-engagement with major powers after the Cold War. Second, rediscovery of the extended neighborhood in Asia. Narasimha Rao's Look East policy and the other policies following it. And thirdly, an attempted redefinition of its ties to immediate neighbors in the subcontinent. So our ties with superpowers, our ties with extended neighborhood, and our ties with immediate neighborhood in the subcontinent. These three will have to be examined in post-Cold War era, especially during the prime ministership of those who led a coalition government, and after that Dr. Manmohan Singh, who led India for 10 years with much more stability. So when talking of re-engaging great powers, we see that India's familiar international universe collapsed with the end of Soviet Union, with the fall of Soviet Union in 1991. And it required that India repair its relations with the West, especially with the United States. And this was one of the most urgent priorities for New Delhi at that time. India's economic reforms opened the space for India's commercial engagement with the West. That had shrunk so significantly during the era of state-led socialism. Finally, the disappearance of Soviet Union freed India to reinvent its foreign policy with major powers and its relations with other major powers of the world. India now did not have to content itself with having relations with Soviet Union only. While seeking better ties with the West, Japan, and China, Delhi refused to abandon its historical ties with Soviet Union, and it kept helping, I can say, Russia, even after it was polarizing with the West. Russia was now more concerned with the West, but India could not give up its old friendship with Russia, and it tried to help Russia in ways it can and it could. So if India was eager to deepen ties with the West, it was also rather wary of a unipolar world which was dominated by America. There were many apprehensions in India when it was opening its market, and our politicians, both in Congress and in BJP, showed their reservations with regard to India's friendship with America. The absence of a great power challenger to the United States meant that there was no geopolitical rationale in Washington to warm up to Delhi. It was not required on the part of America to have close relationship with Delhi, because the Soviet Union had fallen down, Cold War had come to an end, the world had become unipolar. America did not need us. On the ideological front, India's democracy was a valuable virtue. At a time when the West was celebrating its victory over communism. But India being a democracy was not enough to bind India to the West, because so far India had not shown much warmth towards West or towards USA. So, in fact, West and same can be said about United States of America. They focused their attention on some problems which were already haunting Indian democracy. And these were human rights violation, Kashmir issue, and the issue of child labor, on the basis of which restrictions were put on India's export of its carpets. So West was looking at India with these perspectives. It was seeing India in the light of all these problems, the humanitarian crisis in Kashmir and other issues. Climate was also an issue at that time. So this was the scenario when India was trying to formulate its foreign policy in a new direction. Again, one more thing we can discuss here. When India conducted its five nuclear tests in May 1998, when Atal Bihari Vajpayee was Prime Minister, the United Nations Security Council unanimously passed a resolution demanding that India and Pakistan, because Pakistan had also conducted six nuclear tests in the end of the May 1998. So United Nations Security Council passed a resolution and demanded that India and Pakistan roll back their nuclear and missile programs. Nevertheless, India's nuclear tests provided a basis for an intensive engagement with United States, and it also provided an opportunity to resolve the extended dispute with Washington on non-proliferation. India had opposed NNPT, Nuclear Non-Proliferation Treaty, and it had also not signed CTBT. So there was much dispute between US and India regarding non-proliferation of nuclear weapons. And this sanction, this restriction on India in the wake of 1998 nuclear tests provided an opportunity that both India and US sought this problem out, and India exactly did the same. India successfully accomplished the task of solving the dispute between itself and America. Between itself and America regarding the NNPT and CTBT. US had also changed its approach to India's nuclear weapon program under the administration of George Bush. George W. Bush had a very positive approach towards India and if you remember that India signed a civil nuclear deal under the premiership of Prime Minister Manmohan Singh and presidentship of George W. Bush. So Bush agreed to carve out a nuclear exception for India within US law and the international conditions for atomic commerce, because India was ready now to open up about its nuclear reactors. And we signed a civil nuclear deal with the US, and in return, India was allowed to have equipments, to have material for its nuclear reactors, which were in civil area. So we see that a distinction was made between civil and military nuclear reactors. There was much reservation about this, that India is opening its nuclear reactors, its confidential information to the world. But it was a good move on the part of India, because it gave it much sought after acceptance in the world, and India became a nuclear power in the eyes of the world. So India's engagement with Bush not only helped it end its prolonged nuclear isolation, it also facilitated the hyphenation of US relations with India and Pakistan. So far, America was looking at India with the prism of Pakistan. Now the outlook changed, and now America was looking at India in a totally new perspective. So this was something which India had been asking the US to do for a very long time, and it could happen during George Bush and his presidency. If Bill Clinton focused on reducing the dangers of a nuclear flashpoint in Kashmir between India and Pakistan, Bush emphasized India's importance to the world as a large democracy and its potential contribution to a stable balance of power in Asia amidst the rise of China. Bush was also willing to remain neutral in India's disputes with Pakistan. So this was which was beneficial for India in the long term. The political drift in India during the second term of UPA government saw the relationship plateau out after the visit of President Barack Obama to India at the end of 2010. Relationships were very warm, at a very high level when George Bush was president, but it flattened a little when Obama became president.
नहीं सर, वो अपने
So there was a little interruption. Let us continue with the lecture. So we were talking that during George Bush period, India and US had a much better relationship than during any other president's rule. And in Obama's period, we see that the relations between India and US flattened a little. Yet the new growth in ties with United States facilitated a stronger cooperation with US allies in Europe and Asia. But it also complicated India's relations with China, as Beijing began to contemplate the strategic logic behind American outreach to India. Since Rajiv Gandhi's visit to China in 1988, there had been a steady improvement in our relations with China, and the disputed boundary remained peaceful. India's commerce increased with China. Although on economic front, we see that China emerged as the largest trading partner in goods with India. This happy trend of improved relations began to break down by the later part of 2000s. There was a widening trade deficit in China's favor, and Beijing's rising profile in the subcontinent and Indian Ocean caused some concern to India. During the Cold War, India's foreign policy was designed to cope with the dangers of confrontation and occasional collusion between America and Russia. Three decades later, we see that India finds itself unsettled by the emerging dynamic in the relations between Washington and Beijing. The relations between these two countries are a cause of much concern for India. Whether the relations are good or there is a trade conflict between these two countries, it will cause much disbalance, much insecurity in Asia, and it will harm India's interests. And this is why the relations between US and China have caused much anxiety, much anguish for India. And you can see that India has today become a part of many regional organizations. Quad is one of them. So that the balance of power is maintained in Indian subcontinent in Asia. So India's strategy of engaging all superpowers after the end of Cold War succeeded to some extent, and it had a better relationship with US. It had we can say not friendly but working relationship with China. It had good relationship with Russia. So we can say that after the end of Cold War till 2010, we can say that India's relations with other major powers were was almost satisfactory. India's strategy of engagement of all powers is coming under some stress, however, thanks to a number of factors. These include rapid rise of Beijing, the widening strategic gap between Delhi and Beijing, the unfolding uncertainty in US-China relationship, and the breakdown of the post-Cold War understanding between Washington and Moscow. While India no longer has the luxury of unhindered engagement with all the great powers, its potential role as a swing state that could shape the regional and global balance gives it a kind of leverage that it did not enjoy in the past.